I'm going to get into the vision for this year, but before I do, I just want to make an announcement to you all and make sure that we're clear on some things. First and foremost is this, is that I don't have any vision for this church. Isn't that shocking? You would think the pastor would come up here and tell you that he's got everything together, he's ready to go, he's got all sorts of stuff ready, new things planned, it's a new day, new pastor, all that kind of stuff. But I got nothing. Everything that this church has, everything that it is, and everything that it ever will be, is because of Jesus Christ, because of his grace. And if I stood up here and gave you my vision, that would be totally wrong. See, if you walk out of this place today and say, Pastor Dan, I've got your vision, you got the wrong vision. Because I don't have any vision. All that I have, everything that I've got prepared for today, is that which I received from the Lord. And we've never changed the true senior pastor, the real leader of this church. See, Pastor Jim and Deborah were wonderful shepherds in the house. I'm going to endeavor to do my best to be a senior pastor in this house. Pastor Luke, being the executive pastor, is endeavoring to do his best. But we are under-shepherds following the great shepherd, and his name is Jesus. And it's never changed, never will change. We're always following Jesus. Even the Apostle Paul, you remember what he said? Follow me as I follow Christ. So when I don't follow Christ, don't follow me. That's really what he's saying. And so I'm going to get down on my knees, and I'm going to go before the Lord in prayer. I'm going to invite the Holy Spirit to come and give us his vision for his house. And all of us together can grab a hold of that vision, and 2016, as we run with that vision, will be the greatest year we've ever encountered in our lives. Amen? If you would honor the Lord by standing to your feet, I'm going to get down on my knees, and let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father God, we honor you, sir, in this place. We thank you, Lord, for your presence already, God. Thank you for the great things, mighty, wonderful works that happened in 2015. God, it's just astounding when we see numbers like that and when we see the impact on people, God. Each and every one of those numbers represents an individual that you love and that you died for. We thank you, Father God, for saving souls, for raising up people, discipling them, training them, for meeting physical needs, God. Lord, we don't want to stop there. We want to go farther. We want to go deeper with you, Lord. We want to do more, be more for the kingdom of God. We praise you and thank you, Lord, that today as we open up your word and as we hear the vision, God, that you would enlighten it and quicken it to our hearts, God, that we would read it, that it would be made plain, God, that we would understand it, Lord, and that, Father God, that we would be able to run with that vision throughout this year, God. Lord, you said in your word that you would crown our year with your goodness and our paths would drip with abundance. We receive that promise right now in the name of Jesus for this house and for these people, Lord, and we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Holy Spirit, we acknowledge that you are the true teacher of the church, so lead us and guide us. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your direction, your understanding. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Father, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, but Lord, we would also ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both hearing and preaching the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. There are brothers and sisters, Lord, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else. But we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we ask that you bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapel, for Harvest, God, for Oak Valley and The Way, God. We bless Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, the Foursquare denominations and the assemblies, Lord. Bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord, the Sabbatarians that met yesterday, God. We bless them, Lord. Bless Victory, God, and Crossroads and all the great churches that are out there, Lord. Too many to name by name, but God, you know them all. And God, we bless them, Lord, as you would bless us. Father, we also don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. Lord, we ask that you'd strengthen them and encourage them, deliver them, Lord. And we give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. This is Vision Weekend 2016. This is actually part number one. For the next 2 weeks, we're going to unpack the vision. We're going to make it plain. We're going to understand together what it is that God is asking of us and what we're going to see in this coming year. 27 years ago, 12 people gathered together in a rented hotel room, armed only with their Bibles and a box of Kleenex. Now, you might be kind of scratching your head. Some of you guys that are new haven't heard the story, but this church started with just 12 people, Bibles and a box of Kleenex. You say, why the box of Kleenex? Well, was it cold season? Was it the winter time? No, actually, it was the middle of summer in June. And they gathered together and they had that box of Kleenex because their hearts were broken for the lost and for the hurting, for a city that was run down and was in need of a savior. San Bernardino has been called the graveyard of preachers. And when we had built this building, a church had not been built in San Bernardino in over 60 years. And from the time that we started with 12 people till now, this church has had massive growth, has had amazing things take place. People followed the Lord and were faithful to him, and we just honor Pastor Jim and Deborah Cobray and the sacrifices and the things that they did so that we could be here today. Those 12 people grew to hundreds, and those hundreds eventually outgrew that hotel room, and they had to go and find a place, so they rented a facility. They outgrew that facility, had to cross the street. They had a campaign going to the other side. And they went over to the other side, and they got into a bigger building. Eventually, they took over more and more and more of that building. They expanded until 13 years ago, we broke ground on this property, and then we moved into this location. God has continued to do great and mighty, wonderful things. 3 years ago, we started the Freedom for Our Future campaign to pay off the mortgage balance of this church. And this past year, Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah handed over the reins of the leadership to myself as the senior pastor and Pastor Luke Cobray as the executive pastor. Last year, our theme was loving people more and doing church better. We see that we have accomplished that goal. I'm very pleased to announce to you guys today that we have accomplished that. We did that. We were able to love people more. You saw the numbers. You saw the outreaches. You saw the programs. But beyond that, guess what? As a pastor, I'm always watching you guys. Hopefully you know that, okay? I'm staring you down for a reason. I'm watching your life. I'm looking at you, seeing what you're doing. And I saw you. I caught you. You were loving people. You were embracing people. You know, out at the back door, after I greet and shake hands, I see you guys out there fellowshipping and loving each other, letting the kids play out there on the lawn. Sunday night, connect nights in the summer, I saw you guys playing volleyball together and sharing food. I saw you guys out there at the back to school bash. You want to know why I show up a little late and walk around and just talk to people? It's because I'm watching, I'm seeing, and I'm letting you guys see. My job as a pastor, the Bible says, is to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. So I'm letting you guys go out there and watching what you guys do and seeing how you guys put your heart into people who often the world looks at as unlovable. People who the world looks down upon. People who the world would cast out, and yet you're bringing them in with welcome arms and loving people to life. We've loved people more this past year. It's been awesome. Now as well, we did church better. This past year, we went from 3 church services to 2. No one ever likes to shrink. No one ever likes to reduce. And yet, it's a vital part of what we have to do. We had to do church better. We looked at our processes. We're refining processes, taking a look at how people get involved and the different ways that people are going about getting involved. We looked at our ministries. There's some things, something to be said of planned abandonment, shutting certain things down and stopping certain things so that other things can grow and get better. And we're continually looking at those things. All of our pastors have been looking at the departments, whether it be SPT or small groups or the different departments, women's, men's ministry, all that kind of stuff, and trying to do church better. See, loving people more and doing church better wasn't just a theme for a year. It's not like, hey, now it's January 1 and we can put that aside. We did that, check it off the list, and we're all done with that. No, that became a part of our way of life. It became a part of something of who we are and something that we will continue to do. And the vision for this year is no different. The vision for this year is something that's going to become a part of us, and it's going to go with us as well as grow with us as we grow in the will and the way of the Lord. The vision for this coming year is this. If you're taking notes, you can write this down. Make note of it. Find it where you can get a hold of it again and again and refresh and remind yourself of these things. The vision for 2016 and our overarching theme of the year is building a passionate house. This year, 2016, we are going to build a passionate house. Now, once again, I have to define some things. When I say building a passionate house, that's not to say that we aren't already passionate. I mean, come on, somebody. This is the loud church. You're going to find us in the loud section of heaven. I would venture to say even that we are the loud section of heaven, really, when you look at it. I mean, I don't know a place that's more passionate, a place that's more alive, a place that's more loving, that's out there loving people and doing great and mighty things here on the earth. So when I say this, really what we're doing is we're building this and we're growing in this as we develop into this year. Something that we have to develop in our hearts. You know, this year I don't want to be the same that I was last year. Hello? I don't know if you want to be the same. Maybe you're content to just plod along or to just kind of float on the current of the lazy river of life. But listen, if you're coming and getting into a relationship with God, God always is drawing us on. He's always lifting us higher. He's always taking us farther. He's always growing us deeper. God is a God of increase and growth and multiplication, and He wants our lives to grow, not just to plateau. And therefore, we're going to build this passion on the inside of us. We're going to make sure that we are not growing cold. We're going to make sure that we're not getting stagnant. And as we build the lives of others, we're going to build that same passion into them. Now, in order to know where we're going, we have to know where we've been. Let me say that again. In order to know where we're going, we have to know where we've been. That's why I gave you some of the history already. You know, as you look at the Bible, you won't understand the New Testament in its fullness unless you have an Old Testament. That's why God preserved the Scriptures for thousands of years. Because you cannot relate to Jesus as the Lamb of God who was slain if you don't understand the sacrificial system of the Old Testament. See, that would sound like foolishness to somebody who doesn't know the Old Testament. They'd say, lamb? Why the lamb? I mean, why not a, you know, turtle, or why not a dog, or why not, you know, a horse, something strong, you know? Why not a rhino? Why a lamb? When you hear that Jesus is the Lion of Judah, who's Judah? Why is that important? Why would we consider that to be something? And yet, in order to know where we're going, if we're going to go into a deep, meaningful relationship with Jesus Christ, you have to understand both the Old Testament as well as the New Testament. It's the whole counsel of the Word of God. That's why we preach the way that we do, line upon line and precept upon precept. That's why we declare to you the whole counsel of God using the Old and the New Testament. That's why we try and make it understandable and preach with simplicity, is so that we can get a hold of this and grow in our walk with God. In the same way, in order to know where we're going, if we're going to build a passionate house, we have to know where we've been in order to know where we're going. Matthew chapter 16, turn there with me if you will. Matthew chapter number 16. As you're turning there, let me tell you where we're going. Jesus is speaking to his disciples. As he's talking to the disciples, he asks them a question. He says, who do the people say that I am? Now the disciples respond, well, I heard from somebody that they thought that you were Elijah come back. I heard that you were John the Baptist. I heard that you're the prophet. Now Jesus listens to all of their answers, and then he turns the question around on them, and he says, that's great, but who do you say that I am? And it's very important for all of us in this room to confront that question and that issue in our own personal lives. Who do I say that Jesus is? Is he just a good teacher? Is he a historical figure? Is he just a man? Or is he God in the flesh, Lord of all? Now, great thing happens. Peter answers Jesus. And he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now, Jesus in verse number 17 says, well, Peter, you didn't get that from flesh and blood. You didn't come up with that on your own. You didn't hear that out there on the street. That's my own paraphrase, by the way, if you will. You didn't hear that out there on the street. You didn't heard it on the grapevine. But verse number 18, look at what he says. And also I say to you that you are Peter. He changes his name. And he says, and on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades, or the gates of hell, shall not prevail against it. Now, some people have taken that to mean that because Jesus said, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, Peter meaning rock, okay, Petra, that Jesus built the church on Peter. And that's why Peter was the first one to preach on the day of Pentecost with the 3,000 salvations. That's why Peter was one of the leaders in the church. I understand that. I get that. But at the same time, I don't fully agree with that, because there were 12 apostles that went out that started the church. There was Peter, James, and John, who seemed to be pillars in the church. There was the apostle Paul, as one born supernaturally, who went out and started the Gentile church. So even though I understand where they would think that, there has to be something more about this verse. Jesus is saying here, Peter just got a revelation from the Father about who Jesus is. He declares that he is the Christ. And upon that declaration of who Jesus is as the Christ, Jesus now commends Peter, and then he says, upon this rock, in other words, this foundation, upon this cornerstone, I will build my church. What is Jesus saying? Jesus is saying that the confession of who Jesus is as the Messiah, the Christ, that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus is God in the flesh, and that he is the Savior of the world. Upon that confession, he will build the church of God. That's why this house is named the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. Because this church has been built on the confession of who Jesus is as the Christ. Now, as the church, we understand that when we are building the house of God, we are building what Jesus is building. But we can't build it on any other thing than the foundation that which is already laid. And that foundation that we find in the book of 1 Corinthians is Jesus Christ himself. He is the foundation. He is the cornerstone. He's the one that we line up our lives with. He's the one that we take a look at and see if we're doing the right thing, if we're staying in line. He's the one that we're looking to. He is the one that we lay the foundation of our lives and of this church and the lives of others upon. Jesus is the rock. Now, our vision here at the church flows from that purpose. When you see that Jesus is building the church and the church is built on the confession of who Jesus is, and then Jesus gave the disciples the great commission to go therefore and make disciples, the church has two primary principles, okay? Church has two primary principles. Those two principles are number one, winning souls, and number two, making disciples. Now, if you took me to the mat and you said, Pastor Dan, I believe that those are one and the same, I would agree with you. But if you really look at it, there's two separate kind of emphasis, two separate things that we look at, okay? So really, it's one and the same thing. If you're going to win souls, you better make them a disciple. Otherwise, have you really won the soul? And if they're a disciple, they will be won over to the things of the Lord. So I get that. But really, if we want to break it down for our understanding, two primary purposes of the church, winning souls and making disciples. Everything that we do flows from that central purpose. If we're going to be the church that God has called us to be and build what Jesus has been building since the time he ascended and now he's building the church by the power of the Holy Spirit, then it's going to flow from those two purposes, winning souls and making disciples. Our vision, think about it for a second. What is our vision? We shout it out at the end of every church service. Say it with me. That the Inland Empire shall be saved. See, that vision comes from the primary purpose of the church, winning souls and making disciples. So in order for that to happen, we have to do some things. Everything we do as a church flows from that purpose. The rock has seven pillars. The Bible says wisdom has built her house. She has hewn out her seven pillars. And we saw as wisdom some things that made the Rock Church and World Outreach Center unique. And we put those things into seven unique principles, seven unique pillars that make us who we are. It's our DNA, if you will. It's what our family looks like. Pillar number one is this. Aggressive altar calls, winning souls. We had a promise from God that with joy you will draw from the wells of salvation. That's why at the end of every church service we give an altar call. It's not because we want to bore people, not because we're, you know, trying to grind people down or anything like that. We just know that the people that come into church sometimes are the uninformed and the unbeliever. You can see that in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 14. And therefore, since we don't know everybody and we don't know where people are at, we always give an opportunity for people to respond to the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we want to win souls. The Bible tells us actually that he who wins souls is wise. And so we offer that wisdom every time. That's your time, if you're saved, not to check out, not to get up and walk out. Oh, I've heard this altar call before. No, that's your time to pray for people. You can help us to win souls by bringing people to church and by praying for other people who are not yet saved to get saved. And that's your part in that. As well, pillar number two is spiritual personal trainers. It's no good to just get people saved and say, all right, see you later. Hope you make it. That doesn't work. We've got to win souls, yes, but also make disciples. So pillar number two is spiritual personal trainers. One-on-one. That when somebody comes and gives their heart and life to the Lord, they are assigned, they are given a spiritual personal trainer, somebody who will come alongside them and raise them up and train them up in the ways of the Lord so they don't go back to the old ways. Don't backslide, don't fall away from God, but they continue on in the things of God throughout their lifetime. Pillar number three is godly relationships. You can see this in the book of Acts. There were salvations, there was a church built, and immediately they continued, the Bible says, in the doctrine of the apostles and in fellowship and the breaking of bread, and in prayer. So there was a spiritual aspect to the things that they did. That's why we gather for church. You guys need the doctrine. You need the teaching. You need the understanding, the systems of understanding the Bible and what God wants for your life. But additionally, there's something to be said of the natural where we come to a place where we know somebody. You know, at a large church, it's easy to get lost in the crowd and to just be another one of the people in the sea of faces. And yet, we endeavor to get you guys into godly relationships. That's why we have small groups. That's why we have interest groups. That's why we have connect nights. That's why we have volunteer opportunities where you're serving alongside somebody. Because it makes church a whole lot better when you're doing life with somebody. And you know somebody, you're accountable. They're accountable to you. You can pray for them. They can pray for you. You can encourage them. They can encourage you. When you're hurting, they're hurting. When you're joyful, they're joyful. See, it just makes life better when we do it together. You know, I like this statement. And it's that this may be a large church, but really we're kind of a small church with a lot of people. This is family. We're connected together. We are one. And that's pillar number three, is godly relationships. Pillar number four is good works. You saw the good works that this church does. You saw the different outreaches. You saw the numbers. It's astounding what can happen when people get together, believe God, pool our resources, and then God blesses it and sends it out. It's a neat thing. But that term good works is more than just doing good works. It's actually a play on words, if you think about it, because good works. Do you know that? When we do good, it works. Think about it this way. We have the food distribution center feeding 500,000 people every year. We've had people come into our church and they look at how we do what we do and they say, hey, you know, this is really neat. What do you do here? How do you do that? And one of the questions that often comes up is this. Do you require the people who get food at your church to attend? Now, we don't. There's no strings attached. You want food? All you got to have is some sort of an ID. Do that. Show up. There's your food. That's it. We don't require them to come to church. See, people think that the way that we have a big church is we force people who are getting food from us, you got to sit in church service, then you get food. No. You get food. You want to come to church? Come to church. Now, that doesn't make any sense of the natural. Well, wait a second. If it doesn't get people into your church, what good is it doing? See, we may not have the people coming into our church, but we have God coming into our church because good works. But even deeper than that, I've heard testimonies of people who have come to this church who have been distant from God, they've been angry with God, they've fallen away from God, and yet they hit hard times. And they heard about The Rock because somebody told them you can get food there. So they showed up in our food lines week after week after week after week, month after month after month. And finally, they realize, man, this church really loves me. They really care about me. And look what great things that they're doing. Look at all the good. I guess I should check them out and see what they have to say about the Bible. And they came into the church service. Their hearts got touched by the Lord. They gave their heart and life to Jesus. And now they're on the other side of the table serving people, feeding people, loving people. See, good works. Pillar number five is world missions. We support missionaries that we believe are doing something on the planet. We don't have a broad and shallow missions program. We have a very narrow but deep missions program. In other words, we're putting our money into things that we believe are impacting the nations. And so we're not just pouring money into just whatever good cause or whatever the most popular thing is out there. And there are some great causes out there. There's some very needy things taking place on the earth. But we want to make sure to fund missionaries who are working with the native people of the area to develop churches. Why? Because Jesus didn't say, I will build my social justice cause. I will build my good works programs. Even though we do good works as a church, that's not the church. Primary function. Remember, primary function, winning souls and making disciples. We do good works because God said, out of your heart will flow the good works of God, and they will glorify your Father in heaven. So we don't fund those things. We are funding people who are going to develop churches that will win souls and make disciples. Listen, you get a hold of the heart, you'll take care of a lot of the needs. Poverty, sex trafficking. Listen, if you want to get a hold of a whole group of people, you know what they often said? Man, you go after the pimp, you'll get the prostitutes with them. Because if you can get a hold of the heart, if somebody can be transformed on the inside, you want to go after the drug dealers? Don't fight drugs, fight the spiritual warfare and win the soul. So we're supporting missionaries that we believe are doing something on the planet. Dr. Baron and Lisa Gilflin, International School of Ministry, changing the theology of the world right now. They have tens of thousands of graduates in the underground church in China. They've got so many schools, they don't even know how many there are. In Africa, they started showing up in places. They had an ISOM school. They said, we don't have this registered on our books. People were just burning the DVDs. Hey, this is really good stuff. Here, go train somebody over there. And they were just scattering. They don't even know how many schools they have. And yet, God is using them to do amazing things here on the earth. We're supporting Keith and Heidi Hershey. People who have a lifehouse In Beirut, Lebanon, where many of the Syrian refugees are fleeing and coming to find the love of Jesus and hope in their hurting time. We're supporting Mike and Ethel Keys. Many of you guys know them. He's been here. Great guy. Traveling to places, planting churches where no one wants to go. I mean, this guy has to travel by boat and then by foot and go into the jungles and climb a mountain just to find a community of people where he can plant a church. See, our investment into missions is an investment into churches because Jesus is building his church. Can you say amen to that? It's pillar number five. Pillar number six is leadership training. Now, I've had over the years just wrestled with this one and kind of looked at this one and I thought, you know what? Leadership training, what does that mean? Because not everybody's a leader. And that's okay. It's all right. Listen, if everybody was a leader, who would be following? You know what I mean? God set up systems, and it's okay. God put things in order, and that's how it should be. And it doesn't make someone any less of a person if they're not a leader. But when I look at this, I used to think, well, the Bible college, yeah, we do that, and we've got all the ministries have their own leadership training. And so I've always kind of just set that one to the side and said, we're doing that. That's good. But I believe that God wants us to develop this, and especially this year as we talk about building a passionate house. We'll talk about this at length next week as well as our godly relationships, what that looks like. But really, this pillar, I believe, speaks to the equipping of the saints to do the work of the ministry. Whether you are paid by a church or not, whether you are a leader or not, you are called, you are chosen, and you are faithful to Jesus Christ, and therefore you serve, you give, you go out and you minister. You are a full-time minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You are the West Coast distributor of God's goodness on the earth, and you are a leader in that respect. And so maybe we'll change the name of that pillar in the future, but really that's talking about the equipping of the saints to do the work of the ministry. You are a full-time minister. Pillar number seven is planting churches. We've already planted four churches that bear our name. They're great. Pastor Jim, as a matter of fact, right now is preaching at Pastor Henny and Miranda Bosman's church, the Rock Church of Temecula. He's down there, so pray for him. Believe God with him. He's doing three. Hadn't done three in a while, you know, three messages back to back to back. And so he's just pray for strength and stamina and that he's able to deliver the gospel clearly as he wants to and as the Lord gives him grace. But we also have churches that are down there in San Diego, out there in the Coachella Valley in the desert. We have a church on the border of Corona and Riverside. And we have places on our heart. You know, the high desert's on my heart. I see you guys coming week after week. I see you guys driving, man. And anytime there's snow in the pass or there's an accident, you guys can't come to church. And as a pastor, that grieves me. And as well, I talk to you guys, and you're all scattered all over the place. And it'd be great to have a fellowship there that on a Wednesday night you guys could get together, or Sunday morning you can watch the live feed, or whatever it is, whatever that looks like. I don't know what that looks like yet. But someday, I believe that we are going to be planting churches. Maybe we'll go out to Hemet and San Jacinto area. Maybe we'll go over to Lake Elsinore. Maybe we'll go out to Corona. Maybe we'll continue to just expand like ripples of a wave, that God took his finger and he planted a church that was healthy and strong here in San Bernardino, and he's going to use that to go throughout Southern California and eventually around the world. How awesome would it be to have La Roca in Mexico? Come on, somebody. Come on. So now that we've seen where we've been, we know who we are. How do we do this? How are we going to build a passionate house in 2016? If you know what to do, you got to know how to do it. First of all, let me define passion for you. Three things that I see that passion is. Passion is, number one, intense desire. You can be passionate about something because you have an intense desire for it. Secondly, is this strong emotion. There is an emotional connection to it. If you're passionate about it, your emotions are going to be in there. You're just going to be all in, if you know what I'm saying. And finally is fervency in action. You're not just sitting on your hands doing nothing, but you're out there getting it done. You're making it happen. You're moving things around. You're giving. You're going after it. You can just tell. See, passion is often known when you see it rather than by defining it. Think about it this way. Just go to Green Bay. You'll know who's passionate, right? Their houses are painted yellow and green. Dude's out in the stands early, right? He's got the cheese head on. Middle of the game when they're doing good, he rips his jersey off and he's painted from head to toe, right? And he's slapping his belly and he's got the G on his stomach and, you know, he's just screaming his head off and it's 18 degrees outside. What's the guy doing without a shirt on, you know? Passion! You saw it right there. You understand it. Remember when the disciples saw Jesus and they were going into the temple and Jesus looked around, he saw the money changers. Passion came out of him, right? What did he do? He saw what they were doing. He got angry. Now we know Jesus was perfect, and so he got angry, but he did not sin. And so Jesus, there he is, he looks around, and his passion, his zeal for the house of God, he goes out and he starts to braid a cord of whips, and he whips the animals and he gets them out of the temple, he overturns the tables, he pours out the money boxes, and he yells at the money changers, get those birds and those pigeons, get them out of here. My Father's house will be a house of prayer, but not a house of merchandise. And he rips them out of there. Now the disciples, they kick back and they look at that and they go, whoa, did you see that? And then they remembered, remember what it says in the Bible? Zeal for your house has consumed me. See, there was intense desire. Jesus had a passion for the house of God, but there was strong emotion. He got angry, but it didn't stop there. He put that anger to good use, and in righteous anger, he drove them out. He did something about it. See, passion is often seen and not just defined or talked about. Galatians chapter 4, verse number 18, in the voice. This is a paraphrase, okay, but I like the way that it said this. Galatians 4, 18, it says, listen, there's nothing wrong with zeal, or another word for zeal is passion. Nothing wrong with zeal when you're zealous for God's good purpose. And what's more, you don't have to wait for me to be with you to seek the good. In other words, there's nothing wrong being passionate. There's nothing wrong with being emotional. There's nothing wrong with crying, men. My goodness, ever since I became the senior pastor, I've never cried so much in my life. I meant to tell Pastor Jim, what did the anointing go from you to me? Like, what happened here? But there's nothing wrong with having an emotional connection to something that you love, something that you're giving your heart and life to. There's nothing wrong with getting excited in church and shouting hallelujah or saying amen or clapping or any of those things. There is nothing wrong with that. But look at this, and what's more, you don't have to wait for me. Church, you don't have to wait for Pastor Dan to shout and spit and all that kind of stuff. You don't have to wait for Pastor Luke to come up and preach passionately for you to get passionate. You can do this at home. You can do this on the job. You can do this with your family. You can do this everywhere you go. You don't have to wait. We'll be your cheerleaders. We'll encourage you. We'll build you up. That's our job. But our job is to equip the saints. And you get this same fire on the inside of you. All I am is just a spark. Iron sharpens iron. That's it. That's it. Just lighten up your life so that you can carry that flame and that passion for Jesus everywhere that you go. You don't have to wait to be in church to be excited for Jesus. What does this look like on a practical level? A couple of things that we're going to take a look at this in the next week. Four things. The first one is this, is that if we're going to build a passionate house, we've got to have a passion for God. It all starts with our priority. Number one is our passion for God. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, verse number 19, that we love him because he first loved us. In other words, that when we look at God, we get a revelation that God loves us. And because God loves us, our response. See, to every revelation requires a response. And the revelation of the love of God is that because God loves me, now I reciprocate, I love God. Well, how do we get that revelation? Just look at Jesus. God was so passionate. God was so in love that God could not stand eternity without you and without me. Think about that. God could have left us. We deserved hell. God would have been just in letting us go to hell. Because all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And yet God was so passionately in love with all of us that he broke from his side, Jesus, and he sent him to the earth, veiled in flesh. And he lived among us. He suffered and he died. He was crucified, a horrific, horrendous death. But that was the passion of God poured out and expressed. And now God has raised Jesus up and sent the Holy Spirit to us so that we can be with him forever and ever. And ever, when you look at that extravagant, wonderful, amazing, passionate love, it requires no less than all of our love back to God. God is passionate about you. Maybe you didn't know this, but God's watching over you. Not like the old man, you know, oftentimes we get that picture, right? The old man with the gray beard, just mad lightning bolts coming out of his eyes. You're ready to whack you over the head with a 2x4 anytime you do something wrong. That's not God. God is passionate about you. Is God grieved with our sin and our wrong? Absolutely, yes. He does not like it and he does not approve of it. And yet, God loves us so much that he is long-suffering. He's patient. He's kind. He's gentle with us, leading us on, growing us deeper. 2016 ought to be a year that we grow deeper with God. Why? Because God's passionate about us. God loves us, and therefore we need to love him. What you're passionate about defines what you will defend. Do you know that? Think about it. Jesus was passionate about the house of God. Therefore, he defended the house of God. He ran the money changers out of it. You're going to have a fight ahead of you in 2016 with your passion for God. There's going to be distractions. There's going to be deterrence. There's going to be apathy. There's going to be lethargy. There's going to be different things that come along trying getting you off. Sin will try and separate you from God. But listen, if you love God and you're passionate for God, then you're going to fight for it and you're going to defend it. You have to defend your time. You have to watch yourself, church. Part of passion is that, you know what, I am not going to allow my time to be taken up with other things. There's distractions all around. If I could say this to you, I'm like the most distracted person on the planet. You know, I could be sitting there and I'm going to get with God. I'm going to draw near. I'm going to pray. Is that a bird? And for all of us, maybe for you it's not that easy, but maybe for you it's I'm praying and, oh, I got to take this call. Maybe for you it's, yeah, we're going to do it. Oh, the game is on. Maybe for you it's, hey, everybody, I'm shutting the door. Oh, just let me talk to you for 1 second. This is really important. Oh, okay. See, you're going to have to guard your time. You're going to have to guard your attention. You're going to have to defend your relationship with God. You're going to have to make routines. Sometimes people get mad at routines. I don't like routines. You know, you got to break your routines. I get that. I understand that. But at the same time, our routines are healthy to keep us strong and stable in the things of God. Protect that time with God. Protect your study time. Protect your prayer time. Protect your church time. You know, if family's gathering on a Sunday, you better come on Saturday. Better come Sunday night, better come Wednesday night. Whatever you can do, whatever you can get into. See, a passion for God is a passion for his house. When you love God, you will love the things that he loves and you will hate the things that he hates. And when you recognize and realize God hates sin, those who love the Lord hate that which is evil. You will not allow those things into your life. You won't go back to the club. Won't go back to the bar. Won't go back to that old flame. Listen, let that old flame die. Just dragging you down into hell. Listen, if you're going to go on with God, you're going to have to make some hard choices. But if you love God, you will love what he loves and you will hate what he hates. And this year, maybe you have to cut some things off. Maybe you got to cut off the internet access if it's dragging you down. Can we talk? Can we be real? Maybe you've got to cut off some things. Maybe you've got to cut off some of the ungodly routines. If your hand is so used to bringing the stuff, whatever the stuff may be, whether it's a bottle, whether it's a cig, whether it's a smoke, whatever it's a toke, whatever it is, some of you guys need to break, you need to cut that thing off. Why? Because I love the Lord and I'm passionate about him and I'm not going to allow this or them or that or whatever that is to separate me from him. He's my lover. He's my all in all. He's my Jesus. And I'm passionate. It would be sad if we were the same Christian we were last year. It'd be sad if we were the same Christian we were last month. It'd be sad if we were the same Christian we were last week. And it'd be sad if we weren't growing each and every day deeper and deeper. That should be resolution number one for every Christian, is I'm going deeper with God in 2016. But if passion for God means a passion for the house, that means a couple of things. It means attendance. You're all here today, so you can say amen. It's all good. But think about it this way. Passion is often seen, right? Your passion will define where you spend your time. People who are passionate about NASCAR, you'll find them at the racetrack. People who are passionate about baseball, you'll find them at the stadium. People who are passionate about shopping, hello, ladies. You'll find them at the mall. Or some of you guys don't like the crowd, so you'll find them at the computer screen on Amazon, right? Oh, look at the deals. I can't get those shoes anywhere for that price. But see, if you're passionate about God, come on, somebody. You're going to be spending time at his house. So Some of you guys are one a week, one a month. Come on, let's get real. It's okay to be honest in church, all right? But if you're passionate about God and you love the Lord, then why not do two a week? Why not do three a week? Why not be crazy? Do four a week. Whatever you can do. You know, the young adult Spanish-speaking female has the most opportunities to go to church here at The Rock. Did you know that? Because you could get a Sunday morning, you could get La Roca, you could get Sunday night, you could get Wednesday night, you could get women's Bible study, you could get Shift. That's six times a week, young Latinas, all right? You guys have the most opportunity at this church. But listen, I understand you got to work. I understand you got to support your family. I understand some of you guys get taken out of town because of your job, all that kind of stuff. I understand that. I also know that you have to spend time with your family in order to foster that relationship. But at the same time, whatever you can get, you should get. Why? Because you're passionate about the house of God. Psalm chapter 92, verse number 13 says, "Those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God." You know what that means? That every area of your life, if you are rooted in the house of God, will be prosperous and blessed. See, sometimes people forsake church because they want to focus on their family. But if you focus your family on church, your family will be blessed. See, we got it backwards. Wait, I got to focus on my business. You know, I got to put in extra hours. I got to do more. But if you're planted in the house, you'll flourish in the courts. So while you're focusing on your business, your relationship with the Lord is going to dry up. But rather, if you focus on your relationship with the Lord and you get in His house and you're passionate for God, from that life-giving nourishment and sap, it will produce fruit in your business. Those that are planted in the house shall flourish in the courts. What else does it mean? A passion for God means a passion for His house. And a passion for His house means attending, but it also means giving. Now, it's about to get quiet, and I'm okay with that. But listen, Pastor Luke already received the offering, so know that this is not, we're taking up another offering and I'm laying it on thick to get more money out of you. That's not what this is about. This is about your heart. If we're going to grow passionate together, there has to be a sacrificial giving that comes with that. Where your passions are, you will find you spend your resources. If somebody is passionate about a little electronic device that has an Apple on it, they will spend money on that thing. Don't you know they will spend lots of money on that thing? Some of them are more passionate about the little Android guy, right? And therefore, they're spending their money there. Some people are passionate about the way that they look, and so you see how much money they spend on their clothes. Some people are passionate about their interests, their hobbies, fishermen or whatever it may be. And therefore, you see all the reels and the rods and the lines and the lures and all that kind of stuff that they have. What they are passionate about, they will spend their money on. It's no different with us. You know, your bank statement is really an accountability statement. If you look at your bank statement, that's really a statement of your heart and your passion and your desires, your priorities. It really is a priority list. Because when you see the income, that paycheck, right at the top there, just take a look at what the next few things are. Is your priority paying the rent? It's a good priority to have. You should pay your rent. Is your priority groceries? Well, I got to eat. Is your priority clothes? Is your priority your sports or your interests? Is your priority the tithe and the offering? You look at that list, if God is all the way at the bottom, it's time to reprioritize. Because if we're passionate about God, God takes the first place. And when the income comes in, then right off the top, God, hey, you're my priority. You're my passion. And therefore, God, here comes the tithe. Here comes the offering. Amen. Not as quiet as I thought. That's good. But where you're passionate, you will give. That's our resources. That's our tithes. That's our offerings. That's special opportunities to give, like we saw at Thanksgiving and like we saw at Christmas. Those are not just trying to get money out of you. That's giving you an opportunity to express your passions in your heart. Not everybody can go out on a Saturday and go to the convalescent hospital. Not everybody can go out to the streets. But there are people who are blessed with substance who say, you know what, I'm passionate about this and I want to make this happen and I'm going to fund this. I'm going to do it. I'm going to fund the missionary. I'm going to pay into the Freedom for Our Future. I'm going to pay down the church mortgage balance. See, we need to finish strong. We've got 6 months left of Freedom for Our Future. We are not getting off that. That is the next 6 months. And in 6 months, we need to raise over $1 million a month if we're going to make it. Now, some of you all just went, whoa. But guess what? Nothing is impossible with God. And if we're passionate about it and we do our part, God will do His part and we will pay that sucker off. Watch and see. Watch and see. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse number 7, the Apostle Paul is talking about special offerings, talking about collections, talking about generosity, and really giving of finances. And 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse number 7, he says, but as you abound in everything, in other words, you guys got it going on, you're passionate, look at what they're passionate about, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all diligence, and in your love for us, we'd say that's pretty great. Look at what he says. See that you abound in this grace also. In other words, don't leave out your giving. Don't leave that part of your life out. Now, passionate. If we're going to build a passionate house, it'll be a passion for God, number one. When we're passionate about God, we will love what he loves. We will hate what he hates. And our passion for God will be a passion for his house. We will attend. We will give. But also, if we're going to love what God loves, then our passion will go from a passion for God to number two, is a compassion for the lost. God is passionate for people. Jesus died for people. And if God loves people, and I love God, then I'm going to love what he loves. And my heart will go out to those who are in darkness. And I will see the lost, and I will go after the broken and the hurting. I won't leave them on the wayside or pass by on the other side. But I'll stop and I'll offer them Jesus. Give them the hope and the healing that gave me hope and gave me healing. The amazing thing about God is the more you give away, the more you have. And the more you share your faith, the more you're refreshed. He who waters will himself be watered, the Bible says. And sometimes we think, you know, I just can't take care of the needs. But yet, allow yourself to see like God sees. Jesus, in the Gospels, Mark chapter 6, verse 34, and Jesus, when he came out, he saw. What did he see? A great multitude. He saw people. And look at what happened to him. And was moved with compassion for them. Because they were like sheep having no shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. See, Jesus' heart went out for people. He saw them. He saw the multitudes. And we can look around our city. We can look around our nation. We can look around our world. And we can cower in fear. And we can say, it's just getting darker. It's just getting more painful. It's hurt. It's just all wrong. It's all messed up. We can look at it with those eyes. And we can say, you know what? I just want to shrink back. I just want to be in a good place like church. I just want to, you know, be where there's no problems. Can't Jesus just come already? And yet, if you have the eyes of God, if you love what God loves, and you start to look out from yourself into the world, into San Bernardino, into the Inland Empire, into the nation and around the world, and start to see people with the eyes of God and love them with the love of Jesus, your heart will start to begin to be moved with that same compassion. And our compassion flows out of our hearts into our hands, doing good works, telling people about Jesus, loving people to life, praying for people during the altar call, compelling them to come into the house of God, going after those who are backslidden, lost. Maybe you, after this church service, want to call somebody and tell them, hey, you need to get back in church. It's time. It's time for us to call people, to love people, to be moved with compassion. Our passion for God should move us into a compassion for the lost, where we go and we tell someone about Jesus. We get them into a place where they can build their relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Vision Weekend, part number one. Next week, we'll talk about part number two. Amen. God's good. Now, I'm going to dismiss those who are working at the volunteer booths. They're in the leave early section, so they're taking off to go volunteer in the booths. Everybody else, I want to ask that you guys please do me the favor. Just remaining seated. Stay put. Okay, church is not done yet. We've got one more thing we want to do. I'm going to take up 5 more minutes of your time, and then I'm going to let you go. I want to make sure before you leave this place that your heart's right with God, and that if you died, that you would be headed for heaven, and that you wouldn't end up in hell. I want you to just take a moment and take inventory of your life. Where would you be if today was your last day on the earth? Would you go to heaven, or would you go to hell? See, the Bible tells us only one of two places we're going to end up, heaven or hell. Hold on, please don't clap during this time. I want people to focus. That's a distraction. Just take a moment and think about where would you be? Would you end up in heaven or would you end up in hell? Now let's find out why you think you'd be there. I don't think anybody in this room is saying, I'm going to go to hell and praise on, I'm going to go. We're going to have a party, party on, you know, drinking beer and hanging out with people. No one's doing that. No one's that foolish. Hell is a place of torment. It's very real. Sometimes people say, well, I don't believe in a God who can be loving and yet send people to hell. How can you reconcile those two things? Here's how. God loves us enough to give us the free will choice to choose where we go, whether heaven or hell. And hell is a very real place. It's not a fake. It's not a story that's made up. It's not a fable. It's in the Bible, Old and New Testament. See, this is all real or it's not real at all. And Jesus himself spoke about hell. Now, Jesus went to the cross and he died so that you and I didn't have to go to hell, but that we could go and be with him forever, ever in heaven. But God loves us so much to give us the free will choice to choose where we go. He didn't want robots. He could have made robots that love him and that praise him for eternity. And yet he wanted our free will, heart, and life. Today, you've gotten a revelation of the love of Jesus. You've heard the gospel. And you know that God loves you. You know that Jesus died for you. Maybe you've been in church for a long time. Maybe today's your first time ever stepping into a church. Either way, you know that there's a God, creator of the heavens and the earth, who saw us in our sin in a predicament that we couldn't get ourselves out of. Couldn't be good enough, couldn't be smart enough, couldn't be nice enough, couldn't attend enough church. Sometimes people think all you got to do is be good. Listen, if that's the case, then we would have had a rule book. This is not a rule book. This is a book relating us with God, giving us his heart, his character, his nature, his attributes. God's not after rules and regulations for our lives. There was an Old Testament sacrificial system to show us the one who would come. His name is Jesus. And that's why Jesus went to the cross and died for us. He took our place. We deserved the punishment for everything we'd done wrong. And yet, how loving is God that he would come and step down out of eternity, take our place and our punishment. And now he offers to us everlasting life. Now, sometimes people get confused. They think, well, you know, because God did that, now all roads lead to heaven. Can I tell you something? Not all roads lead to heaven. There's nowhere in the Bible that says all roads lead to heaven. It's like us saying all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You will never make it to the moon. The same way, it's God's heaven. We've got to get there God's way. The Bible tells us that wide is the path that leads to destruction. You want to do whatever you want to do, that's probably leading the wrong way. But he says narrow is the path that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Today, I want to show you that way. I want to allow the light of God's word to illuminate the path for you. Jesus came and he said this. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. Just that simple. He didn't say attend church. He didn't say memorize scriptures. He didn't say do this many good with deeds. He said, you must be born again. See, sometimes people think, well, if I just know God or just believe in God, that's enough. But demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. The devil himself knows who Jesus is, believes he's the Son of God, and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that's not enough to qualify him for heaven. So this is not about what you have in your head that counts. It's not about mental ascent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, but rather, this is about your heart. See, sometimes people hear that statement, being born again, and they say, ew, I saw that in a movie. I don't like that. It was weird, and I'm not going to do that. Well, listen, unless you do that, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. So what does being born again really mean? Let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define it for us. What does the Bible say about it? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Jesus is looking for all of your heart and all of your life, not a half-hearted, cold, or lukewarm relationship with him. He's looking for all. Because Jesus said in the book of Revelation, if I find you lukewarm, I'm going to vomit you from my mouth. Only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity, surrendering all of your heart and all of your life to Jesus, being born again, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Here's how it's going to go. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, and when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear that sound, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's push past that today because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? And no one make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity in hell away from God? Come on. Yeah, the devil thinks you're so dumb, he's trying to talk you out of it right now, trying to distract you right now. Listen, don't worry about the people around you. Don't worry about what's going on across the room. Focus in on what God is speaking to you. What makes you think you're going to heaven, if it's any other reason than I'm born again, then I love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. But today, you can take hold of this opportunity, acknowledging your need for Jesus by simply raising your hand. Probably won't even be embarrassed. Listen, you're among friends. In fact, when you give your heart and life to the Lord, you're part of the family of God. These are people that love you all around you. They're praying for you right now. And you can give God all of your heart and all of your life in this safe and friendly place. And even if you are embarrassed, it's better than going to hell. Now, who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before, never giving God all of your heart, never giving God all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know you're a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer, little church attendance, but it's cold, dead religion and not a real on-fire, passionate relationship with Jesus. Come on, get ready to get your hands up. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together, all across this auditorium, wherever you're at, back in the family rooms, if you're watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down, get ready to get your hand up. If you're watching online, wherever you're at, all over the world, hey, God sees, and you can get your hand up right where you're at, and then right afterwards, minimize your video browser, and then click the blue button that says respond to God or go to our homepage, How to Know God. Find that tab, click on it, someone will lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart, and then they'll get some information to you. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three, four, five, six. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Six, seven, eight. Got you over there. Nine up top. Got you. 10, 11. Thank you. 10, 11 on this side. 11, 12. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. 12. Who else today that I did not already see? 12, 13, 14. Got you guys up there. 15 right there. Thank you. God bless you. 15 up on top. 16. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Thank you right there. Got you over there. Anybody else? Oh, back in the family room. Got you over there. Thank you. Thank you. There's two hands. How many? Two hands. All right. Praise the Lord. Where was I at? 17, 18, 19, somewhere in there. We're at number 20. Sitting there wondering if you should do this. Come on. Yeah, you should. Let's go for God. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? I just want to give you one more opportunity. If that's who you know, you need to give God all your heart. Know you need to give God all of your life. Anybody else real quick? Just raise it up high for me when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 19 wise people. Hallelujah. All right, all 19 of you are number 20, you rascal. You know you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. Once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle, meet me up front because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that until we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. If you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on, just make your way to the front. Come on down. Jesus, we love you. From the family rooms, you want to bring your children. They're welcome at this time. Come on down. Come on down. From the foyer, you can come into the church service right now. Come on down. Hallelujah, they're still coming. Come on, you can come too. Come on down. Come on down. They're still coming. Jesus, they're still coming. Come on, you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Hallelujah. There's room for you. Hey, everybody up front, look up here. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, all right? Came to give God all your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Best decision you ever made right here, right now. All right? I don't know if you've heard this today, but I want to tell you this. I love you. Maybe you haven't heard that in a long time. But I love you. This church, we love you. We're excited for you here. Passionate about your walk with God. Okay, so we want to encourage you, want to help you guys out. Right over here is my friend, Pastor Joel, waving at you. Pastor Joel's a really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Okay, I'm about as weird as you're going to get today, okay? He's cool. right? He's going to do three things with you. I'm going to let you know what they are in advance. You're not worried or concerned. First thing he's going to do, he's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again, brand new on the inside, got a brand new heart and a brand new start. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to read about what to do next in your walk with God now that you're a Christian. And then finally, he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Now, sometimes you hear program. I don't really like that. That sounds kind of strange. Listen, let me break it down to you like this. It's a friend in church. Now, that's a lot better, isn't it? Okay? Someone who will come alongside you, teach you some things out of the Bible, help you get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to your old ways, that you can start the new year off right, going on with God, serving him for all your days. Okay? He'll describe how that works, and then he'll let you come right back out. Okay? Your friends and family will wait for you. If you guys will make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Woo!